Welcome to the Right to Reason podcast. I'm your host, Robert Stanley. Today's debate: does Christianity promote or condemn child abuse?
I feel so absolutely stumped.
It's the Right to Reason podcast.
CBS4's Peter Dench has a story from the Horeb Christian School in Hialeah.
Beth Ann Nemec is charged with 7 counts of child abuse at the Horeb Christian School in Hialeah. Among the accusations, a 7-year-old boy said the 180-pound Nemec placed her hand over his mouth to keep him from talking.
Bang, bang, my baby shot me down.
He's one of only 2 Pennsylvania priests to face charges since a grand jury report identified hundreds of abusive clergy. Yesterday, the Pennsylvania State Senate declined to vote on a bill that would extend the statute of limitations allowing childhood sex abuse victims to sue.
On June 20th, 2001, Yates summoned her children into the bathroom where she drowned them in the tub. 4 boys, 1 6-month-old girl.
If your brain's sick, then you can think things that aren't real.
Andrea Pia Yates, guilty of capital murder as charged in the indictment.
Start spreading the news.
This episode of the Right to Reason podcast is brought to you by our patrons and contributors like me. We have all recognized the value of the unrestrained marketplace of ideas and have decided to make a difference.
Start spreading the news.
Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear?
You can make a difference too. Contribute at patreon.com/right and learn more about your right to reason at therighttoreason.com. Your activism is appreciated.
Does Christianity promote or condemn child abuse? Today we're talking to Shane Isgrig and Chris Garrett. Shane is from The Atheist Experience. He co-hosts on that. Also, he is the host of Shane the Skeptic. You can find that on YouTube. Those links are going to be in the show notes. You can also find Front Porch Apologetics links in the show notes today. Chris Garrett's here promoting that. That with our mutual friend Kelly Clemenson, right?
Yes, sir. Glad to be here. Thanks
for having me. He's the best. He was upset about the last thing we said about him because I said that he was like a wall of text on Facebook, but that's how he talks. And then he, like, every comment after that on the Right to Reason thing, he was like, hey, wall of text here. Listen. But it was all good fun.
I love him to death. He's a great guy, but that kind of bothered him a little bit.
He's a cool dude. He's a cool dude. Good to have you back, Chris. Shane, happy to be talking to you, man. You were recommended by our mutual friend Anthony Magnabosco.
And big thanks to him for helping me out and getting me involved in this debate as well.
Yeah, he's a cool dude too.
He really is.
The only time I've been on, it wasn't on Atheist Experience. It was on Truth Wanted.
And okay.
I come out of there. We were drinking, by the way. You can't tell because we're using coffee cups, but we had like whiskey in them. And then,
of course.
Yeah, I got a little hammered on that one. But as soon as I come out of that little studio room that you guys have, there he is. And the dude's way bigger than I thought.
Dan's a really big guy. I remember being next to him. My cousin saw the episode and he paused it. He's like, hold on. And he's looking at us next to each other. And he was like,
yeah, Dan. Dude. Now, I knew Dan was big because I went to a Aaron Ra debate with him.
Okay.
But I didn't know that Anthony was like a tall motherfucker, too.
Yeah, he is. But like, whenever I did Truth Wanted with Dan one time, and I tend to wear shirts that are like kind of baggy because I have a form of autism that makes me like I have like sensory issues. So I don't feel like comfortable in restricted clothing. He had a shirt that was a little bit small on him. I had a shirt that was big on me. And some people were like, these two hosts need to trade shirts.
All my shirts are tight on me, but that's because I'm fat.
Fair enough.
Does Christianity promote or condemn child abuse? I think it might be appropriate if Shane, if you start us off, man.
Okay, so I have a few talking points that I want to bring up, and many of them, all of them are going to bring up their own mini conversations. One of the easiest ones that I'd kind of like to begin with is the verse of Proverbs 13:24, and this is probably the one that anyone reading the debate title would expect to see. The verse in English Standard Version says, whoever spares the rod hates his son, but he who loves him is diligent to discipline him. Before diving into other points that I have on that, I want to ask Chris, according to you, what does that verse mean?
So I'm glad you asked. And this whole question, by the way, does it promote child abuse is actually really shocking to me because I've never even heard that proposition. So I'm glad you ask. Proverbs 13:24. I love the Proverbs. They have a lot of wisdom. This particular one deals with, you got to discipline your kids. And today I think you see a lot of stuff going on in the world where it's like people don't raise their kids and you see the product of that, you know? So if you read the final end of the verse, whoever loves his son disciplines him, you know? So if you're a parent, you got to discipline your child, whatever that looks like.
So are you defining discipline in such a way that it's dependent on physical, you know, like hitting somebody? Because there are forms of discipline that we're familiar with that have nothing to do with hitting a child, right?
Right.
Right. So what is it about someone sparing the rod must hate their son? You know, how do we justify saying that? Because whenever you're talking about hitting kids, I did a little bit of research on like the effects of hitting a child. I want to bring up some of those points without, you know, only using the work of others. But on the issue of hitting children, Sandra Graham Berman, a psychology professor and principal investigator for the Child Violence and Trauma Laboratory at the University of Michigan, she says that it's a very controversial area, even though the research is extremely telling and very clear and consistent about the negative effects on children. We have a study published in 2011 in Child Abuse and Neglect that revealed an intergenerational cycle of violence in homes where physical punishment was used. Researchers interviewed parents and children ages 3 to 7 from more than 100 families. Children who were physically punished were more likely to endorse hitting as a means of resolving conflicts with their peers and siblings. Now, that actually kind of resonated with me because I was actually physically disciplined as a child. And what that taught me was that when you have a conflict with somebody, the appropriate way to settle that conflict is with physical violence.
Okay. Yeah, let's address it, man. I'm sure there's a lot of validity to that study. I don't want to detract from that. I want to actually agree with it. And I'm sorry to hear that you had, you know, instances of that as a kid. I am a product of a split household where my parents divorced when I was young. And my dad did enact disciplinary measures in many ways, that being one of them is spanking, right? And my mother never did, but she was physically, mentally, and emotionally abusive in a lot of ways. So when it comes to this issue, it's actually really personal for me because having experienced both sides of this issue, I believe it's a really clear distinction. Now, just for the record, there you mentioned it is controversial. Yes, it is. Either way you take on this, like my roommate in the other room right here, he's a fellow believer like myself, and you know he's super against physical means of discipline, and you know I'm not for it either. But when it comes down to it, sometimes it's necessary to do certain things. And so it's ultimately up to whoever is parenting, but like it has to be done in the correct way, because there's so many people who would take this as a liberty to say, I'm just going to beat my kids. And it's like, no, that's not at all. That's wrong. That's evil. The Bible condemns it. And I would want nothing less than to dismiss that as absolute evil.
Okay. So what you're saying is that you believe that there are circumstances where hitting the child is the right thing to do.
Yeah. So let me paint a picture for you, right? Child playing in the street, get out of the street. Child doesn't. A car comes speeding. You run and tackle that kid to the ground. Now, is that loving or is that hateful?
That's loving. That's not hitting a child.
Because you're saving them from destruction, right? So in the long-term sense, my sister is somebody who did not have disciplinary action in almost any way at all. And that's not to say physical, that's any way. And she is a tyrant. And I'm not saying that to degrade my sister. I'm saying that because it breaks my heart to watch my own family suffer in this way. And she's making terrible decisions. She's grooming her future for a really hard life. And it's sad to me. So when I see people discipline their child, what I see is a parent who cares. And you can disagree with the means of how that happens, but I don't subscribe to hitting kids like.
Right. So there's a reason why I would call, because it seemed like you were trying to make an analogy with the incident of a child being in the way of a car, right? Like the bus or car coming forward could serve as an analogy for hell or whatever punishment that person has coming forward, and you're using the parent tackling the child in such a way that that's analogous to the hitting of a child to prevent them from going to hell, right?
We're not even talking about hell. We're just talking about life.
Okay.
Here, so
okay,
like,
just life. So the reason there's a difference, and I'm holding to my claim that that's a false analogy, is because in the instance where you have the child with a car coming toward them, pushing or tackling them out of the way is the only way to minimize the harm of that child, as to where when you have a kid who's, let's say, acting out at school, hitting that kid is not the only, actually is not a way to make that child behave. So we have different methods. We have different forms of punishment. And every child's different, so every punishment's different. And that's one of the things that makes parenting so difficult, right?
Right. Right. So I, just for the record, I'm not a parent, so I'm not there yet for those.
Same
of you
here.
Who are.
So I'm glad we could both throw that out there. Neither of us has kids.
This is theoretical. So in the sense that I've experienced, these are my experiences, is when I was punished in certain ways, it was beneficial to me. And I recognize those things because it was never, I'm angry at you, I'm going to lash out at you because you did something wrong, therefore you're going to get hit. It was like, look, don't do this. If you continue doing this, this is the consequence. And then when that consequence comes, to deliver on that is to instill within the child a clear boundary of what is right and what is wrong. And that is not in anger. That is not in hatred. That is in loving care as a parent. Now,
right.
You can disagree with that. We can move on though.
I would say that that's a pretty good example of a person being misled by bad ideas. And that's why these ideas that the Bible teaches are so dangerous, because I think that you're very right. In a lot of cases where you have a person who is that Christian parent who hits their child, a lot of them might not even necessarily want to do so. But if they're reading a book and the book is suggesting that that is the proper way for them to discipline their child, then they're going to be convinced that that is what they ought to do, whether or not they desire to actually do it. And on the issue of hitting a kid to get them to comply, so Elizabeth Gershoff, who is a leading researcher on physical punishment at UT Austin, explains the relationship between a child and a parent who physically disciplines their child by saying, quote, physical punishment doesn't work to get kids to comply, so parents think they have to keep escalating it. And that's why it's so dangerous, end quote. And that is one thing that really resonated with me personally, because I know that, like, as I mentioned earlier, being hit made me think that I had to hit others to resolve conflicts. Well, then what happens when I get in a fight at school? I get hit. Well, then that makes me angry. Like, it just creates this cycle where the behavior gets worse and so does the abuse along with it. And anything that you're getting that you see as being compliant, it's not the child actually respecting you. They might temporarily comply out of fear, which isn't the same thing.
So if I can respond to that, just on the issue itself, is you're attributing violence to Christianity as something that would support it. As somebody who's been raised a Christian, who's been involved in it since I was a kid, the very principles which you're dismissing within the Bible are not dangerous. They have actually kept me from reacting in the ways that you feel that you've experienced, where you want to react violently, where you want to react in those ways. The Bible says, love your neighbors, pray for those who curse you. It says, don't repay evil for evil. These are things that are thematically consistent from the opening to the very end of the book. And it's really surprising to me to hear you suggest that Christianity promotes violence. Now, as far as discipline goes, I'm not going to comment on who does what, but what I will say is it's important to discipline your child, and that is the meaning of the text that you quoted to me.
Well, then what do you think he means by whoever spares the rod? What does the sparing the rod mean to you?
Well, it's a turn of phrase. It's a means.
Yeah, it means like sparing a belt. Like if you spare the belt, as in if you do not hit your child with a belt, you hate him. And that's what this verse means, is that if you do not hit your son with a rod, and actually, I think it's within the book of Proverbs, they teach how to make a rod to hit a child out of a willow tree. They teach exactly what kind of rod they want to be used.
I love this kid.
So, you know, for you to say that you're shocked that I would suggest that the verse promotes or advocates for violence, I mean, we just read the same verse. Whoever spares the rod hates his son, but he who loves him is diligent to discipline him. Now, if you only took the second part of that verse, whoever loves their child is diligent enough to discipline them, I would agree with that part by itself. But the fact that that is used in the same sentence, and that it is used right after a person says, whoever spares the rod hates their son, whoever loves him disciplines him, as in with the rod.
So within the text itself, it's a poetic book, and I'm not going to make the claim that, oh, it doesn't mean what it says, but it is a writing which uses analogies to convey an idea.
Right, now, but this isn't an analogy.
This idea is to discipline your child. So I'm going to have to disagree with you on this one, but I do want to move on.
For sure. We can move on from that. I'm satisfied with that part. Let's see. Up, up, apart from many studies having shown that physical punishment, I just want to add in that, like, even as little as spanking has been proved to cause pain leading to post-traumatic stress disorder, increased aggression, antisocial behavior, physical injury, and mental health problems for children, and that's backed by the American Psychological Association on the issue of spanking children. But I'm willing to move on as well. Now, I kind of picked our first topic. Is there anything you'd like to select for the next topic of discussion?
Well, I just kind of want to stay on the same idea. Does the Bible affirm or condemn child abuse? For me, it absolutely condemns child abuse in a lot of ways. And I can go on for a while on this one, so I'll just try to take it in chunks. So first of all, you're not going to find the term itself, child abuse or abuse. What Correct. You will find is the word revile or reviler, and it's used in both Testaments, Old and New. It's a term means to treat harmfully, to injure, to speak evil of, or to mock, or to make accursed, or to shake. And 1 Corinthians 5 verse 11 says explicitly, to somebody of this nature, don't even hang out with them. Don't even eat with them. They're not people to associate with. Stay away from these people because they have perverted the way of God, because they call themselves Christians and yet they do these things. So it's obviously contradictory from that verse alone. And when you combine it with Jesus' overwhelming view of children and their value, you'll find a pretty clear biblical value concerning abuse, or biblical view concerning abuse. So what I want to ask you is, have you read any of the instances in which Jesus interacts with these children?
With which particular children?
So there's one in Mark 10. It talks about Jesus. He becomes indignantly angry at his disciples who are trying to prevent children from approaching him, because he sees them as valuable. And that's counterculture, not only to the time, but people don't value their children in ways that they need to. And Jesus calls that out here. And he becomes angry with his disciples for preventing them to come. Matthew 18 says kind of a similar thing, in which the child is used to illustrate humility to his disciples. And a few verses later, Jesus says that if somebody were to stumble, one of these children, and cause them to sin, it would be better for them to have a millstone hung around their neck, right? The size of a Volkswagen Beetle, it's huge, and thrown into the middle of an ocean. It would be better for that person for that to happen than for them to cause a child to sin or to harm that child.
Right. I mean,
have you read these?
Not in a while, but I what you're saying does ring a bell, and I'm familiar with, like, I would not argue that there are several Bible verses, including ones that you didn't mention, that set a value on children as being a very valuable thing, especially for them being more pure and more innocent. However, all of the things that were just said by you are similar to the effect of a parent, like what would be said by an abuser afterward. Any abuser, especially in the case of a parent who abuses their child, they can tell you for hours how much they love their child, how precious their child is to them, how much they love their child's smile. They can name all of the things about their kid that they like. But at the end of the day, if what they're doing is this physical discipline that the Bible does actually advocate for, then what we're seeing is that's still abuse. Hitting someone and telling them you love them afterward doesn't mean that you weren't abusing them when you hit them. It just means that you loved the person that you were hitting.
So you're actually preaching to the choir on this one, pun intended. My mom was a religious bigot. She was someone who was very, 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 I haven't seen her since I was 13, but she was very abusive in a lot of ways, right? Mm-hmm. She would call gay people faggots. She would call, and she was one of those. She was one of the hellfire, damnation, screw you, middle fingers up. You're going to burn, one of those, right? Mm-hmm. So when you're saying that it's destructive and it's abusive, bro, I know. I was there. I was that kid who was subject to that. And it's really, really, really detrimental. It really is. Because those people, believe it or not, were called out by Jesus himself. And the religious Pharisees of the day, the Luke 19, Matthew 23, these people were called sons of Satan. They were called brood of vipers. They were called whitewashed tombs, because within them were death and destruction and hatred.
Well, when you say these people, when you say these people, what are you referring to? People who...
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I made it clear. I was making it clear. The abusive religious leaders of Jesus' day.
Okay. Right.
I'm making a parallel. I'm making a parallel between them and my mother, who shared a lot of the same characteristics.
Right. So that there certainly are people who are going to be, let's say, false preachers. And I'm aware. I was warned, because I was raised Christian, well, Catholic, actually, but also went to some non-denominational church. But the point is, I was told that there are plenty of false prophets out there, and I've never actually had a Christian disagree with me that there are false prophets. I mean, yeah, you're right. The Bible actually warns about that. The problem becomes how it is distinguished. Like, what is a criteria a person could have for reasoning out whether a person is actually a prophet, is actually somebody speaking for God, or if this person actually is misleading? Because you have to remember, like, I protested a church that I don't think you would ever attend. I think you're a much—
You talking about Westboro?
Similar to Westboro. There's a church
I would
called,
join arms. I as a Christian would join arms with you against—
Yeah, that. And I'm sure you would. And in fact, whenever I protested, this church was called— the movement was called NIFB, which stands for New International Fundamentalist Baptist. And their church was called Revival Baptist Church. When I went there and I protested this church, there were maybe a third of the people with us were Christians who were protesting with us. So I'm well aware that there are Christians who would stand and condemn that. But the problem with that is those people's followers believe that they are following people of God. And when people believe they are following someone of God, and that person who is teaching them points at verses, and these verses say, yeah, God does command this kind of thing. They can provide other examples. And another kind of thing I would get into is, look at the story of Abraham and Isaac. That's an entirely different can of worms. But people could say, look at these examples. God is obviously okay with you disciplining your child in this way.
So there's a lot there. I just want to remind us to kind of— – we're getting off topic a little bit here. We're talking about false prophets. We're talking about things that don't really relate. I would love to talk about that. I'm very passionate about that. But in the context of child abuse, not super relevant. So,
well, it is when you consider the fact that a person following what to you may be a false prophet— you might call a person a false prophet— that person is hitting their kid. And people at this church are hitting their kids simply because the Bible's Christianity does condone that. And I would also go as far as saying that the Bible's a really logically inconsistent book. So you have verses that say that you should hit a child, and you have verses that seem to suggest that you shouldn't. The problem becomes when you have those kinds of inconsistencies, it makes it easy for a person to use the Bible to promote child abuse or against it.
So that's where the idea of context comes into play. I'm sure you've heard the word. I'm sure you know the argument. Look at the context. Look at the surrounding verses. But, bro, I can't emphasize it enough. For those of you who are listening who don't know, context is looking at the surrounding verses or ideas to establish what the meaning of the text might be. So in this case, we've got an isolated verse in Proverbs, and then we've got a plethora of verses that would go against the suggestion you're making. So how do we wrestle this? It's not a contradiction. It's all thematically coming to one point. Jesus said all of the law hangs upon this: love God, love others. Now, to abuse a child breaks both of those. So because you're diminishing the value of that child as somebody who's been made in the image of God, you're also diminishing their own personal worth. And it's destructive in all of the ways that you mentioned earlier, according to these studies. And I agree with you. It's,
right, but
it's not—
you're
good.
Saying...
But but what the difference is that you're suggesting that we're doing— that people who do hit their children do so on a biblical authority. And I'm telling you that's not the case. Is that when you find people who are abusive to people of different colors, to people of different sexual orientations, to people of any other walk of life, or people who are less than them, like a child who's, you know, only 4 foot tall and they're 6 foot three, the difference is that they're doing so contrary to what God's word says. Now, we can talk about interpretation, and yes,
but
there
they
are
would disagree
who
with you
use
on
the scripture in order to pervert things and say what they want to say. My mom was one of them.
That isn't perverting it, though. That is following it as for what it says. When people hit their kids, they're following what it says.
It says discipline your child. Explicitly discipline your child.
It says Jesus says to love your child, and he says he who loves his child will not spare the rod. So you will not spare the rod for your child. You will hit your child with a rod. And that's a very important thing to stick with. And there are other verses that promote this kind of thing, but...
Once again, this is communicating an idea. I wouldn't take it literal to say... hit your kid with a stick. I would say this is communicating the idea that if your child's out of line, you need to do something about it. So you and I differ on that point. Let's talk about the categories of abuse, right? Because while the Bible doesn't explicitly call out, child abuse as a term, it does talk about verbal abuse. It does talk about emotional abuse. It talks about sexual abuse. It talks about physical abuse and neglect. Right. These are categories that are very important. And is there anything you'd like to say before we jump into that can of worms?
Yeah. So on the subject of abuse, there are really three different types of abuse. There's physical abuse, sexual abuse, and emotional abuse. When people talk about verbal or psychological, that refers to the same form of abuse as emotional abuse. So you really have three kinds, and neglect would fall under that category of emotional. Now,
what about neglect?
Neglect I think would fall arguably under physically. If they're not giving food to a child, then that would fall under physical. But all forms of abuse are categorized under those three things. So verbal, physical, and emotional, right?
I found five, but yeah, we can do those as sub points. That's fine.
Okay. So on this issue, we have a book that teaches people that they inherit sin, right? That they are inherently sinful and that they need to be forgiven, right? This is like pretty much the point of Christianity.
The book begins by saying that we were created in God's image, right? And when man chose against God, we fell from grace, and now we have what's called sin. And then that's why Christ came, to pay our price of sin, of death.
Right, because God made man with infinite life in mind, except when Adam and Eve ate from the fruit, they introduced sin to mankind.
Yes.
And God willed that the price of sin needed to be death. So since he willed that the price of sin should be death and that mankind should inherit sin, he made it the case that he would come down and being half God and half man, which mean that man got to actually pay that price of death. And this is why we're relieved of it. But it's almost like telling a person, like, you are forgiven for being who you are. And it's similar to, like, if somebody told their, let's just say, autistic child, like, I forgive you for being autistic. You're already setting up a kind of mindset where you're telling that person that there is something inherently wrong with them for being that way. And that's an issue that I have.
So, quick question. Do you think you're a good person?
Do I think I'm a good person? I do.
Why is that?
Why? Because I do not wish to cause harm to others. I only wish to promote the benefit of well-being of others. I definitely, like, all of my desires are to promote well-being.
Okay, so you think you're a good person for those reasons. Have you ever stolen anything?
Yes. Oh, is this the right comfort routine? I have done bad things before.
Okay,
yeah.
So for those who don't know, the idea is, look, you think you're a good person, but you can see in your own life instances of theft, of adultery. What I'm saying is that we as humans, what we as humans are flawed creatures.
No, because
and when you're describing the injustices that you see, you're seeing the product of a world who has walked away from God, and you're blaming God for it.
No, because you're not giving me the option to be on this good side. And the point that you were making before about, you asked me if I'm a good person, and then you continue to ask me have I ever stole something. And the argument that you're making is if I have done this bad thing, that therefore I am a bad person. And that is the composition fallacy, because I have multiple character traits, hundreds of them. And the fact that some of those traits are bad does not mean that therefore the entirety of my character is bad. And I don't think that either of us are bad people. And I think it's wrong for a book to tell people that we are bad.
No, what I'm trying to get at is not to say you're not a good person. What I'm trying to say is, how do you define good? In your sense, it's, well, I do things that are nice. My definition is based on what the Bible says, which is, look, ultimate good means that you're without any of this stuff. Now, when God says he is a just God and he enacts justice, what kind of judge would not be, what kind of judge would stand on the pedestal and say, you're all the crimes that you committed, I'm just going to dismiss your case? That's not justice.
So you're,
God must judge sin. That's why Christ came. That's, once again, a rabbit trail I'd like to go down, but
right.
It's a rabbit trail nonetheless. So if you want to detract, that's fine.
Well, the problem is, so you're defining good as like that which God commands, right?
Right. So,
okay, so when you say that God commands us to do things that are good, what does that mean?
Well,
it just means that God commands that which God commands. And then any understanding that you or I have of what good means becomes completely vacuous and irrelevant. Good is a label that we throw on things like happiness, feelings of joy, feelings of pleasure. Bad is a label that we use for things like pain, things like suffering, things like discomfort. I mean, these words don't actually have like broad, clear definitions, and that's what makes them as usable as they are.
Well, you said pleasure would be good. Not necessarily. The Bible says sin is pleasure for a season, but if, it leads to death, then what is that? What's that worth? Sure, it's fun to play in the street, but I'm still going to get hit by the car.
In that case, your pleasure is minimized because you cannot experience pleasure after you die. So the fact that something involves pleasure does not mean that therefore it's a good thing just because pleasure is good. That would again be that composition fallacy. So like a person who does heroin is going to experience a short-term pleasure, But my argument against that is that the pain and that the lack of pleasure that comes from doing heroin outweighs that short-term pleasure that they're going to experience from use.
So I think the emphasis here is misplaced. You're describing the emphasis on us as flawed creatures, and while that's certainly part of it, I think the emphasis biblically is God's tremendous love for us, and he displays it through the cross by taking the sacrifice we deserve on his shoulders. So I just want to put that out there. Now, as far as the categories of abuse that we began to bring up, Proverbs 18, chapter 12, and chapter 15, they describe that words can either kill or they can give life. They can heal, they can hurt, they can build up, or they can stir up anger. And it's clear that, look, you know, how you treat people matters. And Jesus says in the New Testament, I forget where, he says, if you've done it to the least of these, you've done it to me. So however you treat a kid is how you're treating the God Almighty. And it's like, look, you can't be evil in those ways. So I stand with you to say, you know, abuse is wrong and it's evil, but I disagree. It's not from a biblical basis. And Paul, even in Ephesians chapter 4, he says to only speak good. Don't use words that cause rot in the mind. And when you do these things, it degrades the mind of the child. It sets them up for failure. It causes them to sin because now a couple of years down the line, they're making terrible decisions. They're getting pregnant before they're married. They're freaking hitting other people. And it just comes down to a point where this is not good. And for all the reasons you said as well, I agree with you. It's bad, but not for the reasons.
Okay, fair enough. So we were on the subject of the different forms of abuse.
Yes.
And we're all necessary to bring up. So for me, Christianity, it's about instilling in somebody that they are undeserving of happiness, that they are undeserving of good, but that God is so good that he allows you to experience these things anyway. Like, you don't deserve to be forgiven, but God is so great that he forgives you anyway. Is this, does that comport with your understanding of what Christianity teaches?
Yes and no. So at the beginning, God said, he laid out the boundaries and said, this is right, do this. And he said, don't do that other thing. Why? Because he loves us and he wants to give us free will, choice. That's a whole other can of worms. But the idea is that he gave us choice in order that we might choose for or against him. Now, when we chose against him, that separated us from him. And he wanted to bridge that gap. So he set himself in the way of the destruction that we deserve. So that way, through him, we don't have to suffer the consequences of our own actions. Does that make sense? Do you see the distinction I'm making?
I do. I would disagree with it being worded in the sense that we chose to separate ourselves as, like, I am not Adam. Like, I did not do that separation act.
No,
but
you're
I understand
not.
As of what you're saying, like, yeah. I understand
okay.
what you mean.
Okay, yeah. Thank you.
But my issue becomes, let me ask you a question, and I'm sure that you may say that this is a different thing, and then you could elaborate on why it might not be analogous. But I'm in a relationship, and my question to you is, if every day I began our day by telling my girlfriend that she doesn't deserve to be with me, but I'm just such a nice guy that I'm with her anyway, does that sound emotionally abusive to you?
No, but it's a totally different situation. No, no. I see what you're saying, but no, I disagree. That's no.
Okay. I would consider that to be similar, and I would consider that to be emotionally abusive.
I think there's a really good analogy that the Bible itself paints. Have you read the book of Hosea?
I definitely have gone over it time I was in church, so it's been a while.
So you're familiar with the story then. This guy, he is told by God, look, marry this harlot, right, this prostitute. Marry this prostitute. Why? Just do it. And he does, right? And this whole relationship between him and her is an analogy between God and his chosen people. So when she eventually goes out and keeps sleeping with other dudes and is totally unfaithful, what that's doing is painting the picture of us as humans. We are unfaithful. God is not. And it's not to say you're so unworthy, you're unloving, you're unjust, you're this stuff, and God's just like, I'm just such a good guy that I'm going to be with you anyway. No. It's that you're in a place of destruction and he's saving you from that place, from yourself.
Right. The problem is that he put you in that path of destruction by willing that you would inherit sin. Because you believe in the omnipotent, then you believe in a God who could have made it the case that the mankind following Adam and Eve did not inherit their sinful nature. However, the God that you believe in willed that people coming after them did. In fact, when he flooded the earth to kill literally everyone, he repopulated it with one family that was from people who inherited sin in their blood. So, of course, we still have sin. We're from the same people. God could have not made it the case that we inherited it or started from scratch rather than keeping Noah and his family alive.
you're on a great point, and I love it. But the distinction is you can't have a world that's autonomous and exclude choice. You can't have a world of love with nothing to choose. So that would be the distinction. That's why God allowed. And now what you're describing is injustice in all these ways, and I agree it's bad. But those are products of the sin which initially came into the world, which was death. Now when, go ahead.
It's God who makes it the case that if you don't love him, you'll fall into destruction, right? Because like if it's again, like if I were to tell my girlfriend, if you leave me, I'm going to hit you, but I'm not telling you to leave me. It's like, yeah, you can say that she has a choice, but the choice definitely seems a little bit forced when it's love me or be tortured forever. That's pretty different. and I want to give you a chance to respond before I move on to the next topic.
Yeah, I've got a couple topics I want to blaze through too. But once again, justice needs to be met when you're in a courtroom. And how just would it be for any judge to say, yeah, you've murdered 3 people, you've raped 12 women. I'm just going to let you go, though, because I don't want it to ruin your future. Like, what kind of – no, that's unjust. That judge needs to be put on trial, bro. That's –
Right.
So justice demands payment. So that's my answer to that. Now, as far as the different categories, we've got emotional abuse. Fathers are commanded in multiple places. Don't provoke your kids to anger or to discouragement. How we instruct matters. So when you're saying don't hit kids on these bases, I agree. When it talks about sexual abuse, today in our own nation, this is insane. 1 out of 4 girls and 1 out of 6 boys will be abused sexually, assaulted before they're 18. It's crazy, is it not? 1 Thessalonians 4 says refrain from this sexual immorality. In physical abuse, you've got Proverbs 3, which says, don't envy violent men. It's an abomination to God. God reviles this kind of behavior. It's an abomination. It's mentioned 7 times. So that's repugnant to God.
Yeah, okay. That's actually a really perfect segue into what I was hoping to bring up next. So you're saying, if I'm not mistaken, that God condemns sexually abusing, say, young girls, and that God does not want you to, say, idolize violent men, right?
Yes.
Okay. Are you familiar with – now, there are 2 verses in the Bible that I want you to read specifically. And as important as context is, I want to allow you to put this in context and make it sound okay. So could you read Numbers 31, 17, and 18? I could tell you – I know them. I have them memorized, so I can tell you what they are if you need me to. But if you want to read them yourself.
That's fine. I got it here.
Okay, cool. Numbers 31, 17, and 18.
Yeah, cool. If this is the one I'm thinking of – now, therefore, kill every male who among the little ones, and kill every woman who has known a man intimately. Keep alive for yourselves all the girls who have not known a man intimately. As for you, remain outside the camp 7 days. It goes on.
Okay, so we're talking about killing men, killing little boys, killing grown women, keeping alive girls who are virgins. And if you continue to read on, it talks about forcing them into marriage, which literally is talking about sexually abusing them. Just imagine being some young girl and having your family killed in front of you by these people who are being commanded by God, by the way. Your family's killed in front of you. You are then kidnapped and forced into a marriage. Does that not sound like men being violent and sexually abusive?
Well, to be clear, the Bible says Jews are not to take wives of other nations. So
okay, but that doesn't respond to the verse that I brought up. Yeah, it's a separate
I said first off.
Okay.
Okay, so yes, and you bring up a valid point. You read this verse and you think, what the heck is going on here, right?
Right. And when people say there's context, I'm willing to hear the context that makes that okay.
Right. So we're dealing here in a world in which I've mentioned it a few times. It's a fallen world. This is not the world God intended. This is the world in which we live. Mm-hmm. And in dealing with it, this is dealing with the people who is wicked, just like the Amalekites, just like some of these other people. God has in the Old Testament commanded that Israel wipe out certain nations. And it actually lists the reasons why. It's judgment. God is judging these people through his chosen people. Now, this is specific to this people at this time. This is no longer relevant to us as people. We can take the situations and learn from, okay, what happened and why. But they
it
are
was
not,
okay man, for them God. To do that?
In this instance, this is God enacting judgment on others.
So you're literally referring to the act of killing a little girl's family in front of her and then raping her as God's judgment.
There is no raping. Like, there is none of that.
Okay. Not kidnapping that someone and forcing them into a marriage isn't raping them.
There's no forced into marriage. They don't marry them.
Okay. I would encourage people to continue reading from Numbers 31 and to read Judges 28 as well and see if I'm mistaken on that. But from my understanding, it is about killing a little girl's family in front of her and then raping her. And if you think I'm wrong, then we should ask, why were the virgin boys killed? Why weren't the virgin boys kept alive? Like, what motive do a group of violent men who just got done killing everyone in a village have with virgin girls? What is their motive with them?
I can't answer you. But what I do know is that God, in certain times, asked the nation of Israel to wipe out a certain people, and they left certain people alive. Now, those people came back a couple decades later and tried to wipe out the Israelites, right? And you can say, well, I can see why, and But the idea is God is enacting judgment. He said a thing, do the thing.
Right, now, we have a term for an entire people trying to wipe out an entire other people.
Genocide.
And that's called genocide. So so what you're saying is that God does promote genocide.
No. What I'm saying is in this situation, God commanded judgment on the people through his chosen people.
And
this
by judgment, you mean wiping them out?
Let me finish my sentence. Okay. This is not a command to all believers to go and kill everybody. Now, you want to go down that road, I would love to open up against Islam. Because that is literally commanded hundreds of times, not hundreds, dozens of times. And there's a lot there. As far as this is concerned, this was for specific people at a specific time to do a specific task. Now, to those listening, I know this is probably like, wait, what? And yeah, I agree. For me as a Christian, these are things that we wrestle with too. We're like, okay, what do we make of this? So just in honesty, these are not comfortable issues, but they're things that you got to deal with. You got to read them. You got to figure out, okay, what's this actually saying? When you compare texts like this against the rest of Scripture, including a couple chapters before, you get God saying, look, I'm not sending you to judge these people because you're any better. You're not. You're worse. But I'm sending you because they need to be wiped out. Now, let me throw another analogy your way, okay?
Okay.
Now, groups of people like this were involved in idolatry. They were involved in murdering their children on, you know, burning idols on their hands. They would lay them down as a sacrifice. They were involved in all kinds of things, including rape like Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, when you see these people being wiped out and judged, well, how dare God, you know, but when you look at it, it's similar to a rabid wolf running through a playground and tearing children apart. Now, you as a parent would be morally responsible to kill that dog, else it kill more of your children. Right. So if these people are corrupting their people, which if you go through the Old Testament, you see how prone they are to idol worship, to sacrifice, to all these things. You see how destructive these things can be. God is protecting his people from their corruptions. Does that make sense? Do you understand the sentiment?
Yeah,
so the sentiment is if there's a danger, you have to get rid of the danger to protect the little ones, just like we're talking about the child abuse.
OK, so if you are a. Maybe not a modern Christian, but maybe a previous Christian, or even in this case, maybe an Israelite. What you're saying is that it makes sense from a biblical perspective if you believe that another people are fallen, that they are doing things, you know, their culture promotes things that are sinful, that it is your duty to wipe that culture out.
Not at all.
Okay.
That's okay. Judgment is to God and God alone. And when he commands a thing like he did here explicitly, do what he says. But the rest, all of this is explicit. Don't be violent. Don't go out and hurt people. Don't do these things. And the opposite is continually affirmed. Love your neighbor. Pray for those who curse you. Don't go out and do all these terrible, horrible things. Mm-hmm. Did you know the Old Testament condemns rape as punishable by death, among other things? Did you know that? So you're talking about, oh, they're going to rape these people. No, that's not the command.
The Bible also says thou shalt not kill, but we also have multiple examples of it commanding killing, right?
It says thou shalt not murder.
Well, it depends on which translation you read.
Okay.
That's an important thing. Yeah. Thou shalt not kill is the King James version, like the first English translation we have, thou shalt not kill, right? And I have here a new King James version, and this one says what you said, thou shalt not murder. But most translations that I'm familiar with say thou shalt not kill. Now, it says don't kill, but we have countless examples of killing being the command. So I actually agree with you. There are verses that that condemn rape, but there are also verses that actually command it, and that's part of my issue with it.
No, not at all. I'm just going to disagree with you on that point.
Do we have time? Because I know we're running short. We haven't really got into the subject of Abraham and Isaac. Would that detract from whatever you wanted to dive into?
Tremendously.
Okay.
But, yeah. I want to ask you this before we close this out. I want to ask you this, Shane. Mm-hmm. Can we stand in arms and agree? Child abuse, rape, murder, these things are wrong. These things are evil.
Yes, we can. And I'm glad that we can.
So can we also join arms and say that we should attack ideologies that promote or allow for these sorts of things?
Yes.
So considering that Muhammad is the pattern of conduct for Islam, I know you're probably not studied on this. I study this a lot.
Right.
He was not only an abusive white slave owner who owned black slaves, he was not only a violent murderer who commanded the violent subjugation of all non-believers, not even combatants. This isn't self-defense. This is people who don't believe. This is a neglectful liar to his wives who constantly broke oaths with his sex slaves. He was a rapist who was also responsible for much of the world's genital mutilation for little girls. He also consummated marriage with a 9-year-old.
Correct. Those things are all...
Let that sink in. He married a 6-year-old and consummated when she was 9. Pedophilia,
yes.
Rape gangs, violent extremism, terrorism, blatant misogyny, all of these things. You want to talk about child abuse? Let's start here.
I agree with you. Like, I take a stand against Islam as well. The issue that I don't think you're understanding is I have a problem with pretty much all religions, not just yours. So your criticism of Islam isn't a criticism that I disagree with. Oddly enough, there are Muslims who have criticisms of Christianity that I agree with. And I find it interesting to watch people of different religions condemn each other's religions for reasons that all three of us agree on. Because I have friends who are Muslims, and all of them would tell you that they think child abuse is wrong, they think pedophilia is wrong, but we look at what their holy book says, and it's
right.
Like, that's, you know...
Right,
and
so that would be an instance.
That
like
person would feel the same way about you seeing Numbers 31 and going, okay, this is what your book promotes. And both of you can point the finger at the other one and say, your book promotes this. I'm here saying, I think we should stop following these ancient texts that were written when people didn't know anything about the world.
So that would be the difference with the Catholic priests, where they're diddling kids, they're doing the stuff, right? But they're doing so contrary to the Word of God. And I can show you hundreds of verses that say so. But right. When they do it with their jihad, with terrorism, with these things, they're doing so in accordance with, in direct command of their prophet. Now, Jesus said love. Muhammad said kill.
Right. So I think our disagreement is that your religion is that when someone does these things for Christianity, that it's doing it contrary to the Bible. So like the same
correct.
Way the person
yes.
who,
yes.
you know, the same way the person who flies, you know, flew the planes into the Twin Towers probably was doing not what they felt contrary to the Bible, the Quran actually said. I think in these instances where people are hitting their kids with rods or doing similar things, you know, I think that it is not contrary to the Bible. I think that they're doing what it actually says. And I think that's our main point of disagreement, because you're not here defending child abuse. You're here arguing that child abuse is not being promoted. But it's interesting when...
No, that it's condemned.
Like, or I'm sorry, yeah, condemned. So between me, a Christian, a Muslim, and a Hindu, all of us will agree that certain actions are wrong. Yet anytime I read a holy book that commands or even just justifies, maybe it's not a commandment, but justifies that exact same action, I see the religious people defending it. And it makes me question why they think their morality is objective when it was okay in this certain circumstance.
So the difference is where someone like yourself, you're atheist, you don't believe in a moral authority. There is no basis for which you can dismiss something as evil or wrong. You can say, I don't like it, I disagree with it, but there's no basis to say so. For myself, I'm basing off the belief that there is a God, and this God created us with intent, and what he says goes. And when he says killing is bad, when he says abusing children is evil, I tend to take him at his word. So as for, you know, the ideas that you hold, they produce certain outcomes. And I'm not saying that you are dangerous, but what I am saying is that the moral framework of atheism allows for these things without any, you know, objective truth. And then we've got things like the LGBTQ community trying to include pedophilia as a legitimate sexual orientation.
That's not true.
Well, it's what's in the news. That's what's happening today.
That's not true.
I know a lot of left-leaning Democrats would disagree with the idea, but it is being promoted. And it's even shown within Cuties, the show on Netflix, and SB 145, which if you don't know, San Bernardino County, where I'm at, they just passed a bill that allows anybody who's 14 to have intercourse with anybody 10 years or older with no legal recourse. How sick is that? So you want to talk about, you know, what's right and wrong. I would say, where do you get that from? Just like you're saying for me, but the difference is that the God who made the universe, who establishes what is and is not right, is my authority. So as far as just to recap, I as a Christian would dismiss child abuse as evil and wrong on the basis of scriptural authority. In 1 Corinthians 5:11 is what I want to emphasize. Don't even associate with people who are this way. So that is my closing statement. Thank you for having me here.
Okay. I'd like to begin by responding to your claim that if I'm an atheist, I have no basis for a framework for morality. That's not true. My basis is empathy, well-being, pain, and pleasure. This serves as a very effective framework for morality, as far as I'm aware. Anybody that I know thinks of me as a very moral person. I don't see any issues with living my life the way that I do. The difference between somebody like me and somebody who believes in a God is that person who believes in a God claims that they have the source of some ultimate authority, yet look at you versus other people who claim to be getting their commands from the exact same God, and they fundamentally disagree on these issues. There is no way of telling which one of them is actually getting this authority. I mean, if you want to say some people are getting it wrong or some people are misinterpreting it, then you're saying what that would mean is that your God has a moral obligation to correct them and at least let them know what his take on it actually is. I have to comment on what you said about the LGBTQ community wanting to include pedophilia. That is absolutely false. There are maybe people who are pedophiles who are trying to include themselves in the LGBT community, but that is not the same thing. Everybody that I know who is an LGBTQ person, which I should mention probably makes up half of the friends that I have, finds the thought of a person doing anything with a child to be absolutely disgusting. Some of them actually support a death penalty for it. And this would be people who are actually normally opposed to the death penalty, but justify it for this instance. So I would strongly disagree with that point. I would also add at the end that Christianity holds to the idea that Abraham's willingness to kill his own child in obedience to God is an admirable trait. Christianity, it promotes the idea that people are deserving of punishment, and not just punishment, but for that punishment to be torture, then be saved of it. I find these to be abusive ideas. I find it abusive to tell a person that they're broken, and it seems like there's a point of that we agree on, but you're disagreeing that that is what your religion promotes. So in closing, I'd like to say that, Chris, you're a better man than the God that you believe in.
Don't say that. Real quick, just to tap on the Abraham Isaac thing, we didn't get to really touch on that, but just briefly, it's not that, you know, it's good that he was blindly obedient. It's that God had promised that through his descendants would come the Messiah. And if he's asking him to take the life of his son, he knows that he's going to resurrect his son. This is not an act of blind faith. This is an act of God made promises, and he wouldn't contradict himself. And he knew that these are not things that are characteristic. So he understood that God was trying to prove a point. And that point is that 2,000 years later, he would send his own son to die on the same hill for you and for me.
Chris, that is your second closing.
Yep, thank you. Sorry.
But
we didn't get a chance to touch on that specifically, so without having addressed it.
In all fairness, Shane got to open and you got to close. For the listener's sake, Shane claimed that later in that chapter and Numbers that it talked about marriage. Chris, I think he's got you there. Verse 32, it says, "And the booty being the rest of the prey which the man of war had caught was 600,000. Boom. They referred to it as booty. Owned. But anyway, I'm just kidding around. Guys, thank you.
Bro. That's why we love you.
Thank you so much. I found this conversation not just to be interesting to listen to, but I learned a lot from it.
Shane, thank you so much. I love the interaction. And for you too, thank you so much for having us on your show.
Yeah, you too. Thanks to both of you. I like to see conversations where people actually get along and are polite to each other rather than, let's just say, cussing them out and yelling at them like some atheists do. Because I see a lot of that happening, and I think that if you and I can have a discussion where we strongly disagree but are polite to each other, then we can serve to promote that kind of conversation. And people seeing that happen, I mean, you as an apologist, me as a counter-apologist, can promote something that we join arms in, and that is polite discussion. So I thank you for being decent and polite as well. Robert, I appreciate you for organizing this conversation very much.
You can find Shane Isgrig on his YouTube channel, Shane the Skeptic. He's also a regular co-host on the Atheist Experience. I would also recommend you check out Front Porch Apologetics. That's a Facebook page, is that right?
Yes, sir.
Front Porch Apologetics. You'll find all those links in today's show notes. Guys, thank you so much.
Thank you, too.
Thanks for having us.
Love is all that I can give.
Thank you to Shane and Chris. Thank you to Dave Blair at DaveBlairMusic.com. Thank you to FeedSpot.com for promoting the Right to Reason to the top 10 atheist podcasts. They are in the show notes as well. Thank you to our patrons, Jason Parker, Cletus, the slack-jawed yokel, he wants you to support the atheists of Utah and PA non-believers. We've also got Alan Marks, Tara, Philip Spawn, Bernard Lamborel, Enema Man, Larry Wilson, and the largest patron and my personal friend, Rob Montgomery. You can support this broadcast at patreon.com/right and learn more at therighttoreason.com. Next week, I will be talking to a real white supremacist. And to correct his racist claims, we'll hear from a psychologist that has dedicated his life to confronting white privilege. Between now and then, remember that you have the right to reason.
The right to reason? More like the right to suck.
The right to reason. Not great, but okay.
Three things better than this podcast: rape, slavery, and Auschwitz.
Unsubscribing to this podcast.
The right to reason sucks.
I would listen more, but I'm like busy and stuff.
Just like your fat wife, the right to reason is okay-ish in bed.
I only listen to the right to reason because the silence makes me want to commit suicide.
I don't like this podcast very much. Tell me quick.